this committee operates under the open meetings law, a copy of which is posted in the back of the room by the door. And as usual, we'll start with just some brief introductions. And I'll just start by introducing our guest today, Mr. Chuck Reed, who is the former mayor of San Jose, California, two-term mayor, last served in 2014, and who's here today as a director of the Retirement Security Initiative and is going to share some thinking and ideas about pensions with the committee. And he could actually introduce himself, but we very much appreciate you being here today, Mr. Reed.
Happy to be here.
And Gina, why don't you go ahead?
Gina Simpson.
I'm Richard Evan, the committee chair.
Trent Fellers with the city council.
Lincoln Zier with Hampton Enterprises.
I'm Don Herz, retired city finance director.
And I'm Dan Marvin.
Our first order of business is approval of the minutes from our last meeting, which was January 21st. We've all received copies.
Move approval.
Second.
Is there any discussion about the meeting minutes? If not, Molly, would you call the roll?
It's been moved and seconded.
Okay.
Trent.
Richard Evans.
Yes.
Trent Fellers.
Yes.
Don Herz.
Yes.
Dan Marvin?
Yes.
Gina Simpson?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So we're going to move into a presentation by Mr. Reed. And we may very well be here the full 2 hours. I think we're going to hear a lot of interesting and important information today, not necessarily things that everybody will like or agree with, but important nonetheless, and consistent with the work of this committee, which is to look at a broad range of ideas and thoughts about pensions as we evaluate the status of these pensions in Lincoln, Nebraska, and what, if anything, ought to be done with them. So in the name of learning more about that, we've invited Mr. Reed, who has considerable experience both in San Jose and elsewhere in pensions, and we welcome you today to share those ideas with us.
Thank you for inviting me in. Happy to be back in Lincoln. I always appreciate the cold weather, nice and crisp. I have a lot here I can talk about for a long time. But I also want to be able to deal with questions and comments the committee have. I always enjoy talking about what you want to talk about in addition to what I think should be talked about. And so I'm happy to take questions as we go along. And if we don't get too long on time, and I'm sure the chair will move us along if we get behind. And then there's time at the end for questions as well in terms of whatever you may want to talk about. First, I always have to do disclosures. I talk about pensions and retirement issues around the country. It's always good to do disclosures. I'm a lawyer, and I'm used to dealing with lawyers, and public officials are always in their disclosures. So let me start by saying, first, that I'm a Democrat. And I was a Democrat mayor in a Democrat city with 9 out of 10 Democrat council members, one Republican. I'm a CalPERS pensioner. My 14 years in elected office, I earned a pension. And I want to make sure I get paid every penny that I've earned. During the time I was mayor, we went to the ballot 5 different times on 5 different tax measures, successfully asking the voters to do things to improve our revenues. I'm an advocate for retirement security. I think that there's value in defined benefit plans, but I also know that the defined benefit system is unstable and risky, even though I think it's desirable and certainly appropriate in many, many occasions. But I also believe that taxpayers should get a reasonable level of services for the taxes they pay. And so that's what brought me to the Retirement Security Initiative as a director. I'm going to try to get the first slide here, see if I guessed right. I did. So these are the principles of the Retirement Security Initiative. I'm a director. I have four other members of the board of directors who come from a variety of areas with experience in pension and retirement issues. Dan Lillenquist, who is a former senator from the state of Utah, was the author of the bill that got approved by the legislature and implemented in 2010 to restructure their pension systems after they went through the devastating losses in the market in the 08-09 time period. Richard Ravitch, former Lieutenant Governor of New York, who has the longest experience in the area, going all the way back to New York City in 1975 when he was part of the team that saved New York City from bankruptcy and reorganized and restructured some of their fiscal matters in order to do that. He's currently involved in advising the Treasury Department as well as the government of Puerto Rico on how Puerto Rico can deal with its severe fiscal issues. Lois Scott, a former CFO of the city of Chicago, a lot of experience in Chicago in very difficult circumstances. And Jim Spioto is the fifth board member, chairman of the Chapman Strategic Advisors, and has represented many bondholders in bankruptcy proceedings, most recently in Detroit. So our initiative is a bipartisan advocacy organization. We're focused on fairness and solvency of public sector retirement plans. We believe that state and local governments have a responsibility to provide essential services that protects the safety, health, and welfare quality for all Americans. That state and local governments have an obligation to ensure that their retirement plans are sustainable, fiscally sound, responsibly managed, to make sure that all retirees and employees get paid what they have earned, and that the solutions to the funding and cost problems need to be developed with input from employees, retirees, labor, management, taxpayers, and fiscal experts. The reform principles that we follow as we go about our work around the country are as shown in the slide. Retirement should be safe and secure. Plans should be fair, sustainable, and predictable. Benefits should be funded as they are earned, and incentives to underfund commitments should be eliminated. Unfunded liabilities should be paid down. Management should be open, transparent, non-political, and there's no single solution that works everywhere. As I'm sure you'll find as you go through the process here, lots of other people have done lots of other things, and I'll talk about some of those today in the survey, but they won't necessarily be the model for Lincoln, because Lincoln has its own unique characteristics and issues. I'll start a little bit with my San Jose experience. How I got into pension reform. This first slide is essentially a summary of my years in office. I was on the city council for 8 years, 6 years before I was mayor for 8 years. We had 10 years of cutting the budget and cutting services every year to balance the budget. And then in 2011, we adopted a fiscal reform plan. Part of that fiscal reform plan was a pension reform ballot measure that went to the voters in June of 2012, and it got a lot of national attention because it's such a surprise for a Democrat city and a Democrat county and a Democrat state to approve pension reform by nearly 70% of the vote. San Jose is the capital of Silicon Valley, the 10th largest city in the country. We have over 1 million people. Our general obligation bond ratings have been AA1 or AA+. We have been number one in job creation almost every year for the last 6 or so years since we came out of the recession. We've never taken a pension holiday. We have two independent plans with independent boards, and they have earned in excess of 7.5% on their investments since their inception. And yet, we had billions of dollars of unfunded obligations, in excess of $3 billion. So the question is, why would a Democrat mayor in a Democrat city and a Democrat state take on this really difficult issue of pension reform knowing that it would be divisive, difficult, and complicated to do. But in San Jose, we decided after 10 years of cutting services to balance the budget that we had to begin to focus on the cost. And we did that because the alternative was worse, and that was service delivery insolvency and bankruptcy. And so we drew the line and said we had to start focusing on cost. And the cost of pensions were and are enormous in San Jose. The slope of the line looks a lot like Lincoln's in terms of the increase in costs. San Jose is not an outlier when it comes to the ramp up in costs. We may be an outlier in terms of our ability to deal with the problem, but this slope of the line that you see here and you see in Lincoln are very common around the country. It's very common for jurisdictions to have tripled their payments over the last decade or so, as has Lincoln. And many, many jurisdictions are grappling with the problem. So the unfunded liabilities that you see and the payment increase that you see have unfortunately been quite common around the country. I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the cases around the country, other jurisdictions that have done things. We circulated to the committee ahead of time a survey of about 60 or so jurisdictions and what have done that. That survey is just a cryptic explanation of what happened. It's a starting point for analysis. It doesn't include all jurisdictions and doesn't include all the things that all the jurisdictions on the list did. So it's a starting place for analysis. So I'd recommend anybody who gets curious about a particular jurisdiction to go to Google. Probably do it on Bing. I don't know. I just use Google. Put in pension reform in the name of jurisdiction, you'll get probably a Ballopedia or a Wikipedia page or a pension tsunami page with lots of links to lots of media coverage and legislation. You can track down what happened in a particular jurisdiction. But there are some common characteristics or generalizations that I think you can draw from looking across dozens and dozens of examples of pension reform. First, many of the jurisdictions had formal bargaining and negotiations with their public employee unions. Some did not, but many did. Almost all, but not necessarily all, had opposition to whatever it was they were trying to do. There is no easy way to do this work. And most of them had litigation. Even if they had negotiated a resolution with their public employee unions, there usually was litigation. The rights of individuals that are affected by the changes that some jurisdiction did belong to the individuals, and they could assert those rights. Or they negotiated successfully with some of their unions, not all of the unions. And so typically there was litigation, and you can track that litigation. There's a web page called Litigation Tracker. You can look and see what happened in some of the jurisdictions. The other generalization is this is an iterative process. And as has happened in many jurisdictions, some of whom started doing pension reform measures a long time ago, but they're back at it again because it's hard to solve the problem. Jurisdictions have done what they can do. Given their economic constraints, their political constraints, their budgetary constraints, but they didn't necessarily solve the problem, and many of them are returning to it again. It takes a long time from beginning to realize you have a problem, figure out what you should do about the problem, to implement the solution, and then receive the benefits of that, the savings. It takes years, not months. And the other thing that is not always clear is that pension reform alone is rarely enough to solve the fiscal problems, because cities are doing pension reform because they have fiscal issues typically. And pension reform alone is rarely sufficient to close the gaps. And as you can see in San Jose, in the 2011-12 timeframe, we had a downward tick in our payments into our plans. But what we did with pension reform and the ballot measure really was about a third in terms of dollars impact on our fiscal problem. So we basically closed $100 million shortfall in our general fund, and about a third of that was a direct result of the pension reform ballot measure. And so as you look at trying to solve the fiscal issues, there are more things that have to be brought to bear if you're going to be able to do that than just pension reform typically. Other reforms and more revenue are often a part of the solution. Out of the 60 or so jurisdictions, I think there are probably five states and five cities that are interesting and relevant to Lincoln in some way. I'd just like to go through those. First is Nebraska. Can't ignore Nebraska. We're in Nebraska. The most interesting about Nebraska is when you look at the list of underfunded plans, there's only five in the entire state plans that are underfunded, the measure that's used by the state, compared to other states where there are hundreds. And that's primarily a result of the fact that in 1983, Nebraska shifted most plans from a defined benefit to a defined contribution system. But you can't ignore Nebraska. You're in the middle of Nebraska. And what happened in Nebraska is always relevant to the discussion of what you may or can do in Lincoln. Arizona, I think, is very interesting for your purposes because Arizona is right in the middle of a major effort to do some pension reform. They have legislation that is in the state Senate or has passed the Senate and is going to the other house, will probably go on the ballot to modify their constitution in May. So it's interesting to see what they have done for a couple of reasons. First, as it was their fire union, the state fire union, that started the effort to negotiate some changes into their system. While Lincoln's system is certainly underfunded, Arizona's was worse. And Lincoln has a 13th check that affects the so-called excess earnings, but Arizona was worse. And so there was no way for their plans to recover from their underfunding because of the way they were moving excess earnings in a way that wasn't guaranteed a 4% COLA, but was the primary reason for wanting to have a negotiated resolution. And so the legislation, as it currently stands, shifts to a guaranteed 2% COLA, a real COLA, in exchange for many other things that they did. But it was the fire union that led the way into negotiations. I'm not sure the police union is going to go along, but it's notable for the amount of negotiations and effort that they did. So they changed the COLAs. They're starting to pre-fund the COLAs. New employees are going into hybrids with a choice, depending upon if they have Social Security or don't have Social Security. They will split the cost for the new employees on a 50-50 basis so that the employees share the risk, something that's not necessarily the case in most jurisdictions and is not the case in Lincoln. They limited spiking, increased the retirement ages for those new employees. But it was a negotiated resolution. You can look at the legislation. It's available now, and it'll be played out in the next few weeks. I think they expect it needs to be passed next week in order to get on the ballot in May, or it has to go to a following year. Minnesota is relevant, and interesting, first because it's not too far away, but it was a state in which they did make changes to their pension benefits that affected public safety. Basically, they reduced benefits for future years of service, keeping what everybody had earned and accrued, but changing the rates for future years of service and reduced COLAs in the process. Rhode Island is one of the leaders on pension reform because of the significant changes that they did statewide. Those changes were generally negotiated, although they didn't get unanimous agreement from everybody, and they did end up litigating it. But they did do things that affected police and fire. They passed those in 2011, included suspending COLAs when the plans were underfunded, retirement age increases for current employees, and a defined contribution plan was added for new employees. Utah's a state I mentioned earlier. Dan Dillenquist is one of my directors, was the architect of the changes in Utah, which they did in 2010. They ended double dipping and restricted COLA limits for current employees. New state and local public employees, teachers, police, firefighters, and legislators, everybody except judges, get to choose a defined contribution plan, or a hybrid plan, which limits the state costs because they have a cap on how much the state will pay, whether it's a defined contribution or a defined benefit plan. There are five cities that I think are interesting and relevant. First is Omaha. Can't ignore Omaha because it's not too far away. Happens to be one of the two police and fire plans. It's on the unfunded list in Nebraska. And they've made some changes. They've negotiated some additional payments and some benefit changes. But their changes haven't solved their problems. And they remain on a funding percentage in a weaker condition than Lincoln. But they have been doing things in dealing with their police and fire, and certainly their experience is useful. Baltimore did multiple reform efforts. 2010, they increased retirement age and contributions for current public safety employees. 2013, they changed the COLAs, tiered them by age, increased contributions for current civilian employees. In 2014, it created a choice for the employees to choose between a defined contribution and a hybrid plan. They've offered that same choice to the public safety, but they're still talking. San Diego went to the ballot for their pension reform in 2012. They capped pensionable pay, and they created a defined contribution plan for everybody except police officers who remain in their defined benefit plan. In San Jose, when we went to the ballot, we went three different times on different pension reform issues, 2010, 2012, 2014. We made changes that affected current employees, created a new tiered defined benefit plan. We chose not to get rid of defined benefit plans because we thought they had value, but we require our new employees to share 50-50 in the costs of those plans. We eliminated bonus checks. We had a 13th check. We eliminated those. We reduced retiree health care benefits. We did some governance reform to bring in people with expertise who didn't have vested interest in the plan, true independent expertise. And we restricted arbitration for police and fire so that the pension reform measures would be factored in to the cost of salaries in a total compensation basis instead of separately. St. Louis increased the contribution rates for firefighters, reduced benefits for future years of service for current and new firefighters. St. Louis is a little bit unusual because they only dealt with firefighters, but they had a plan that was in serious trouble. And that's what they took up. Now, if you look across these dozens of plans, not just these 10, but the many dozens where they've done pension reform, I think there are some things you can say about them. And if you consider the hundreds of other places that have done one thing or another, there's a range of alternatives that kind of frame up the kinds of things that you can consider for Lincoln. The first is to do nothing and hope for the best. There are a lot of places that are doing that. Basically, they're putting more money into the plans, cutting services, and raising taxes. And that's pretty common because, as I mentioned earlier, doing pension reform is complicated and difficult. But those that have engaged in pension reform, most commonly is to make changes for new employees. In most states, new employees don't have any employee rights because they're not employees. And the path of least complication typically is to deal with new employees and avoid lots of issues for current employees that way. New employees are being dealt with in a variety of ways. In some instances, they're creating new tiers within existing defined benefit plans. Los Angeles is on tier six for their public safety employees. They still have a huge problem, but they're on tier six, and so they've just made changes within the existing plan, modifying the benefits with each of those tiers over the years. Many jurisdictions are using cash balance plans, which can be done within an existing defined benefit plan. Many jurisdictions are doing new plans for new employees, basically freezing their existing defined benefit plans and going to a cash balance plan for new employees, defined contribution plan for new employees, and probably more frequently are hybrids for the new employees. A side-by-side hybrid, which is a defined benefit on one side and a defined contribution on the other side, covering the same range of pay, or a stacked hybrid, which case you have a defined benefit plan for the first $30,000 of salary and a defined contribution plan for the next $30,000, or some combination, but they're stacked in that way. And these are done with or without Social Security. Wide range of variations on how they relate to Social Security. Many jurisdictions have had to take up changes for current employees because when you're faced with a fiscal crisis and you deal with the new employees, you realize that the fiscal help is a long ways into the future because the liabilities that you have today are attached to current retirees and current employees. And if you make changes for new employees, while you may save some money on them, it starts small because you don't have very many new employees. And so jurisdictions that are faced with very difficult fiscal situations have had to make changes for current employees in order to generate the kind of savings they need to help solve their problems. It's very common to eliminate the extras, such as 13th checks or bonuses in some fashion. Very common to increase employee contributions. And there have been many contracts around the country that have been negotiated to increase the employee contributions. There are many jurisdictions in which the employees don't make any contribution, and the employer picks up the employee's share. And so increasing the employee's contribution by some percentage points has been very common.
Mr. Reed, if I could interrupt
yes.
you for just a moment in connection with that. When you have seen the increasing the employee contributions, what have you seen in connection with that in terms of benefits? I mean, typically negotiations, if I'm going to increase my contribution, I'm going to want, there's a follow-on or a trade-off of an increased payout at some point. Are those increases in contributions completely concessions, if you will, or is there some other negotiated benefit that goes along with that increase?
They're typically negotiated as part of a major, the contract. And so other wages elements and other benefit elements are all part of the negotiations. So you have contracts in which the employees are getting a raise, but they're also increasing the amount that they're going to pay. There are some contracts where employees didn't get a raise and they increased their contributions. You know, that's a pure concession. It depends on the fiscal circumstances and other things that are going on in the jurisdiction. But I'd say it's fairly common that the raises are moderated by the increase in contributions or a shift in how the contributions are done. But when you open up the contract, everything is on the table. And so certainly when the unions start the negotiations, they start wanting something in exchange for something you're going to give.
Sure.
Although I'd say probably increasing employee contributions is the most common first step, but most places that have done that are back trying to do other things. Because if you have the employees pay another 1%, you know exactly how much it's going to save you. And you can look at Lincoln or anyplace else and realize that, okay, 1% is helpful, but it may not be enough, and they tend to get revisited in the next round of negotiations, because the problem doesn't really go away. The unfunded liabilities still are driving costs up. Reducing COLAs, even for current employees, COLAs for their future earnings, or COLAs even on their past earnings. Reducing accrual rates. If you slow down the accrual rate, or you stretch out the retirement age, or you reduce the COLAs, you can have significant savings on those unfunded liabilities. There are shifts to cash balance plans within the existing defined benefit plans for current employees, basically freezing the benefits as they are and then changing the structure of the benefits going forward for future years of service, so that employees aren't giving up what they've already earned, but it does affect ultimately where they come out at the other end for retirement. Those are basically referred to as soft freezes. Basically stop putting people into the old benefits and moving them into new benefits. And those can be done with defined contribution plans as added on, or cash balance plans, or hybrids of all of those, with or without Social Security. I don't know very many places where that they're not in Social Security, that they want to go into Social Security. The times that I've seen people run the numbers, the unions and the employers usually agree they can provide a better level of benefit with that same amount of money than going into Social Security. You've got to run your own numbers to see that, but that's a common conclusion. Another area of possible value is in employee choices. There have been some jurisdictions, while they have created a new tier benefit for new employees, they've offered the existing employees an option to go into that tier or some other tier. It saves the employer and the employee some money, because they're stepping down the value of the benefit and the cost of the benefit. Some jurisdictions have done that, but there's a real problem with it, and that is at the IRS, because it's the IRS's interpretation that as soon as you give the employees a choice, you have a problem with constructive receipt of income, and it gets real complicated. And the IRS, when I left office last year, had about 24 requests for private letter rulings on that topic sitting, and some of them have been sitting for a very long time, because the IRS can't decide what to do on the topic. And there is opposition at the national level from the national unions opposed to giving the employees a choice, because they fear it will be used as a way to take advantage of the employees and cut benefits. So the IRS is not issued very many private letter rulings, although that is some jurisdictions, you don't need their permission to do this. Some jurisdictions have gone ahead and have done it. It's just is another whole set of problems. Some jurisdictions have made changes for retirees, reducing your COLAs, even though they've already retired, or reducing your future COLAs, even though they've already retired. Some jurisdictions have cut earned and accrued benefits. Typically, those are jurisdictions that have gone into bankruptcy. If you look at what happened to Stockton and Vallejo in California, the pensions were maintained, but health care disappeared. Retiree health care disappeared. Central Falls, Rhode Island, pension payments got cut in half. Pritchard, Alabama, they just ran out of money and stopped making pension payments. In Detroit, the employees were given a choice of, we can reduce your benefits by 10 or 15% if you agree. If you don't agree, we're going to cut them by a much bigger amount. So vote however you wish. And so there were real cuts to real benefits for real people, real retirees, and real employees in Detroit in the bankruptcy. Bankruptcy is not a happy place. It's not good for anybody. There's a lot of pain in bankruptcy. And it's part of our motivation of retirement and security initiative is to keep cities out of bankruptcy, help them figure out a way to pay their obligations without going so far that they've gone into bankruptcy. If you look across all of these things, there's probably 100 different things that you could do. And you know, there is no one answer for Lincoln, as I said earlier, as anyplace else. And I think part of what you need to do is to begin the analysis with what I think are value decisions. And these value decisions really are the factors that I think help you decide what to do about plan design or solution or whatever it is you're going to do. And that taking up and understanding these value judgments are important at explaining your plan to the people that you need to convince whatever you're recommending makes sense. So I'm just going to go through those a little bit, and I don't expect to get answers from you today, but I would leave these questions with you, maybe help you as you try to decide what to do next. First is cost and cost sharing between employees and taxpayers. Somebody has to pay. These benefits are earned, they're accrued, and you have to have a way to pay for them. And many of the assumptions that we have collectively relied on for decades have turned out not to be very good assumptions. So you have these enormous unfunded liabilities. But fundamentally, somebody has to pay. And you have to decide that, you know, who's going to pay and how's it going to be allocated. Either the employees are going to pay or the city's going to pay. That's it. Unless you expect the federal government to come in with money, and I don't think it's worth holding out for that. So if you're going to allocate the cost, you know, that's a value judgment of who's going to pay what share. You have to ask yourself, how much can the city afford to pay? How much can the employees afford to pay? And those are really important questions because some of these benefits are so expensive, not necessarily in Lincoln, but around the country, that nobody can afford to pay for them. Cities can't afford to pay for them, employees can't afford to pay for them. And that's why they have to be changed. But there is a principle on the cost and cost sharing that I think is important. And that is the sharing of the risk of the cost. Because people respond to economic incentives, and if there is no risk to the employees, they act differently than if they share the risk. In many defined benefit plans, the employer takes all the risk. Employees' contribution is fixed, so if the assumptions turn out to be wrong, or the investment returns turn out to be low, it is the employer or the taxpayers that takes all that risk and pays all that cost. And so that generates some perverse incentives for the employees and their representatives to lowball the normal cost. Because they're paying, if they're paying typically a percentage of the normal cost, and the city's picking up all that excess, the cost for the unfunded liabilities, a very common characteristic of defined benefit plans. The whole attitude in psychology changes when the employer and employee share the risk 50-50. Then while there are certainly economic incentives that affect people, you've shared that risk. So now the employer and employee have the same incentive to try to make sure the plans are fully funded, that they're well managed, they're well run, to keep the costs under control, because there is no laying it off on the taxpayers in the future. And that 50-50 cost sharing is an important element, or some apportionment of the cost sharing is an important element to consider. The second area to consider is the benefit level desired. A lot of times we just focus on the cost, and we don't think about what should the employees get at the other end of a 20 or 30 or 40 year career with the city. What should they come out with on the other side? Do we want to have a maximum amount of what we will pay for retirement? Do we want them to have a percentage of their salary? And is that the last year, 3 years, 5 years, the average of a career, but a percentage of salary? And what do we do about inflation adjustments? Because many people are retiring and living longer, And so inflation is an important factor in the retirement years. So how do you allocate that retirement inflation adjustment? Those are the COLAs. The third area is the risk and the risk sharing between employees and the taxpayers on things that affect the cost, like investment returns. Should the employer take all of the risk on investment return? Or can we moderate that risk by the way we invest our money and how we set the assumed rate of returns and the discount rates in the plans? Who's going to take the risk of longevity? Should the employee take the risk if they outlive their money? Or is that something that's better taken by the employer? And what if they all live a lot longer than we thought they would, which is the case today? I used to get off the airplane in Washington, D.C., and there was a big sign there that said, when this airport was open, the average retirement age was 65. The average life expectancy was 65, and now it's 78. Have you planned well for your retirement? We know that our employees are living longer, and that's a good thing. But that means there's more cost to the plans. And how do you allocate that risk? None of us want to outlive our money. And one of the good things about defined benefit plans is the employee doesn't have to risk outliving their money. But the employer has to figure out a way to manage that risk as well. Inflation is another factor. We've had a long period of very low inflation, but some of us can remember periods of very high inflation. And how should that risk be allocated among employer and employee? And then the payment risk. We think that the employer, typically in a defined benefit plan, has all of the payment risk. But yet, if you look at the plans around the country that are very poorly funded, the plans that are in weak jurisdictions, who may go into bankruptcy or some other kind of default, the money's not in those plans. So the employees have a payment risk. And you know, the employees need to be able to account on the payments being made when they should be made. Portability is another important factor. And as you look at the demographics and the kind of workforce you have, because even in government, we're finding lots and lots of our employees aren't staying for 20 years. There's a lot of them, good people, that we're happy to have. They're only going to stay for 10. And there are many defined benefit plans that are pretty much backloaded. You don't get a lot of benefit of working for a short number of years, but yet there are many quality people that you might want to attract by having something that accounts for that in a way of portability. You have to consider the impact on employee retention and recruiting, because employees, just like everybody else, respond to economic incentives. That's a factor in their analysis. But what I've seen is employees, when they're first starting out, value retirement differently than they do when they're closer to retirement, as we all do. And so as you structure what you're doing, you have to think about that retention and recruiting in the short run and in the long run. Legal restraints and risk are important factors to consider. We all operate within the U.S. and state constitutions, as well as local codes and contracts, and there are legal risks that have to be managed, and that's a conversation you better have with lawyers. But they do affect your decision making and help frame up what you can or cannot do, and the amount of risk that you're willing to take is important. One thing that I would say underlines everything is that no matter how you design your plan, no matter what you do, if you don't put the money in, it won't work. And many, many plans around the country are underfunding, systematically underfunding their plans. And that is a recipe for failure. A good plan design will not save you if you don't put the money in. And ultimately, as a city, you have to figure out how to put the money in. And that's part of the task, maybe not your task, but it's a task of the city. And then finally, once you decide what you value most and you set your priorities, then plan design will be easier, but it will never be easy. And your recommendations for specific things that need to be done are not going to be easy, but it's important work to ensure that your employees get paid what they've earned, your retirees get paid what they've earned, and your taxpayers get reasonable services for the money that they're paying in their taxes. So with that, I think I'm done. Yes, I am.
You mentioned your second to last comment was, you know, making sure the funding is going in as appropriate. I guess I would say it differently than as required. We had a lot of conversation with our actuary, a lot of debate around the table, you know, taking this 30-year underfunded port component and amortizing it off over 30 years. The city had converted from an open-ended to closed-ended 2 years ago, maybe. You know, but as a practical matter, that number just grows to a point where you just simply then turn around and open it back up and re-amortize it. I mean, it's, you know, it's pushing the penny uphill over and over again. All of which is, you know, as we stated, perfectly within the plan and perfectly within the plan design and perfectly within, you know, accepted practices in actuarial computations. So I don't want to imply again that anybody's done anything that they shouldn't have done. We did ask the question of the actuary. What are you seeing? Because the implication in your statement is that if there's an unfunded obligation, you pay it, and you're not. I mean, again, we've had conversation around the table that, you know, every time you have an unfunded dollar, it's not giving you a return. And so your return requirements are going up every time you have an unfunded component because you're not getting that investment return. What have you seen around the country, or as you've talked to people, are people shortening that? Are they biting the bullet and taking that over a 10-year period, or are they writing the check? I mean, we're in a smoothing scenario, so we're not at the market rate, so we don't have that component that's impacting the required minimum payments, but we're still ending up with this unfunded component that we're amortizing. What are you seeing?
That's another one of those value judgments. How much do you think your children and your grandchildren should pay of the obligations that you've incurred?
Right.
Because those unfunded liabilities are what you should have in the bank today. And so by amortizing them over X number of years, you're shifting it into the future. So there's a value judgment there. The trend, I would say, is to continue to shorten that. This open-ended, where you refinance it every 30 years, you never pay off the mortgage because you refinance it every year, that's really going away. I mean, the GASB rules, Government Accounting Standard Board rules, are pushing people away from that open-ended amortization, and they're pushing towards shorter amortization periods. And, you know, there's the 30-year because a lot of people do it. But there are many plans that are on shorter time periods. And if you were to say, you know, where would you pick a number in between paying it off tomorrow and paying it off over 30 years, if you look at the service life expectancy of your employee pool, you need to have the money when they retire. And that's somewhere around 15 years. So there are a lot of plans that are in that 15 to 20 year range, looking at that service life expectancy of their employee pool. But it's a value judgment. There are certainly people who believe you shouldn't push that off onto your grandkids. I haven't told my grandkids yet how much they're going to get to pay, but it is you know, that intergenerational transfer. Actuaries are okay with it. It's just numbers, but there's a value judgment in there.
Can you talk a little bit? You took what on Ballotpedia, it talks about your proposal, but then it talks about how there was litigation over that. And most of the provisions that dealt with the pensions from whatever was B, whatever proposition.
Measure B, or ballot measure B. Yeah.
That the provisions that were directly related to pensions, the courts didn't find that you could do those. So can you talk a little bit about, when the dust settled, how the ballot initiative actually had any impact on the pensions? And because the chart here is rather dramatic, in terms of reversing that, but if the court struck down the impact on adjusting, using the ballot initiative on pensions, I'm not sure how this chart matches up with.
Well, as you'll see when you look at.
I might suggest that you just give us a little background on the ballot initiative in case people aren't familiar with it.
Okay. As you'll see when you look at any jurisdiction, you know, the cryptic summary I provided you is not everything that people did. So in our ballot measure B, it had 15 different provisions in it. Some of those provisions dealt with, had impacts on new employees, some on retirees, and some on current employees. And the primary impact on current employees was to require them to pay an additional 16% of their pay towards their retirement costs. There were changes for new employees, with a new tier, new level of benefits, still a defined benefit system, but different. Elimination of the 13th check, which affected retirees as well as current employees. Some changes in the health care plan that affected how much retirees have to pay for health care. Some governance issues and a few others. So in California, the general rule is that you can't make changes for current employees because what they expected on the day they were hired is vested, not necessarily what they've earned so far, but what they expected. And you can't change that for 70 years. So San Jose has a provision in its charter that the city council retains the right to change retirement benefits. So relying on that provision in our charter, we made changes that affected current employees. That issue has been litigated in a whole bunch of states. In some states it went this way, in some states it went that way. In our case, the trial court ruled against us as it impacted current employees. So we were not able to implement the increase in payments for current employees. The court ruled in our favor on most of the other provisions. And when you sort of net it out into dollars, the savings from the provisions that were approved by the voters and approved by the court are about $30 million this year, in this fiscal year. And it's about a third of that $100 million gap you're looking at on that graphic. Now that number goes up over time. It's about $3 billion over 30 years, because it affects new employees and that number grows and some other things in there that grow on an annual basis. So we were not able to do something that affected our current employees.
Now, so San Jose had an unfunded pension plan.
Yes, two of them. And unfunded liabilities in about in excess of $3 billion.
And the proposal that was on the ballot, then later litigated in the courts, did that change the relationship of how that unfunded balance was paid down? In other words, it doesn't sound like the employees were chipping in more from that. So the city just had to deal with the unfunded balance as they would have prior to the ballot initiative. Is that fair to say that?
Mostly. So the changes that we made on health care, you guys are also talking about pensions, I haven't thought about your health care issues, but the changes that we made in health care affected the unfunded liabilities in our plan. So we actually had a drop in unfunded liabilities based on some changes on the health care. But the unfunded liabilities are the unfunded liabilities. As you can see from the graph there, and we had a downtick in costs in 1 year, and then the slope change flattened out a little bit. So essentially what we did was, as I said, you have to pay the unfunded liabilities. You need to put the money in.
Right.
So the city is still putting the money in.
Are they funding at the actuarially
yes.
required or suggested rate?
Yes, both. Whether you call it the required or the suggested, we're funding it and always have. So the city has to continue to put the money in, but what we're doing is we're saving money on the other side that allows us to have the money to put into the plan.
Right.
And that's probably the most common thing that is being done is if you can do something for your new employees, it saves you some money that allows you to have more money to put into the plans because it doesn't affect the unfunded liability. It affects your capacity to fund the payments.
In San Jose, it said they have like 4,000 employees. Were they all DB, defined benefit employees? Or do they have a defined contribution? The city of Lincoln has a split where the only DB people are firefighters and the police officers.
San Jose had, at the beginning of that period, 7,400 employees.
Okay.
Almost all of them in a defined benefit plan. And at the end of that red period, in the end of the bleeding, we had 5,400 employees. So we cut 2,000 jobs out of our workforce. That's how we balanced the budget for 10 years, was by cutting the workforce. And we decided, okay, we reached the end of the line. You know, when you're laying off firefighters and police officers, you've pretty much reached the end of the line for, you know, attrition and cuts in services. And that's when we decided we couldn't do that anymore, although we did lay off firefighters and police officers. So we shrank the workforce, saving us, of course, a lot of money. We did a series of other fiscal reforms, consolidating, contracting out, being more efficient, eliminating some things, making a lot of other things. It added up to some serious money. The biggest one, of course, was the pension reform, which covered about a third of that gap. But the biggest one of all was pay cuts. All of our employees took a 10% pay cut. So if you can't do anything about pensions, wages are negotiable whenever the contract rolls over. So we negotiated pay cuts with our employees. 7 out of our 11 unions, union leaders and the union membership ratified 10% pay cuts, including our police and fire unions. That was not fun for anybody. It was very hard on our employees. But the alternative was, at the year of the 10% pay cut, to lay off 500 more people. And so, you know, but those negotiations were how we helped, you know, close the gap.
You got went to the ballot because your pension rules are in the city charter. Is that?
Yes.
That's the reason. Is ours in charter or is ours in the municipal code?
No. The charter addresses the ability of the city to create the pension, and then the Lincoln Municipal Code lays out the details of the pension benefits.
So there's some difference there in our case.
Yeah, we had to go for a charter change because there were provisions, not all of them. We got ordinances that deal with the details, but a lot of the provisions were in the charter. And we went to the voters in 2010 and got permission to put new employees into different plans, unspecified as to what they would be. That was in 2010. And in 2012, that Measure B, which is the more famous one, specified what the benefits would be for those new employees going into those new plans. I didn't completely answer your question, Mr. Mervin, in the sequence, the litigation. So the voters approved it. We had litigation. Court ruled yes for 12 of 15 provisions. We won some, we lost some, in other words. And so then it went on to appeal. And in the course of that appeal, negotiations continued. Negotiations hardly ever stop, right? So negotiations continued. And there have been settlements reached with 10, maybe 11 of the unions.
It said the last I'd read was 10 out of the 11, but that was just in December of 15.
Recent, yes, what I'm saying.
Fairly recent.
Yes, well, they're still going on. Those are tentative settlements for the litigation, and the retirees, I think, are still not settled with yet.
And then, excuse me, these were negotiations specifically About pension issues?
The...
Or the issues that were part of the ballot measure?
There were pension issues, but they were part of the ballot measure. It's all tied in together. But it was a settlement of the litigation while it was in the Court of Appeal. So the litigation settlement is a little bit different than what the voters approved. So the requirement to pay an additional 16%, that's not part of the settlement. The changes to the benefits for new employees is still part of the deal. Various elements have been modified a little bit. And, you know, and in the negotiations, you never know what's going to happen. There was actually a new element with regard to the health care. So the 10 or 11 unions have agreed that new employees will not go into the defined benefit health care plan, that there will be a dollar amount defined contribution health care plan. So that got put in. That wasn't part of the Measure B. But, of course, in negotiations, sometimes you're looking at how much money is on the table, and some things get swapped in or out. And so the total savings still amounts to about $30 million in this fiscal year and aggregates up to about $3 billion. But again, it's not final, but those are the tentative.
Switching subjects, maybe go back to this, but you mentioned, because when we had our actuary in here, we talked about the 13th check and her experience with that made it sound like Lincoln was a little bit odd in having a 13th check program, but then by your conversations, it's not an uncommon practice.
Detroit had one too.
To have a 13th check.
And Arizona is getting rid of theirs. And so I wouldn't say it's common, but Lincoln is certainly not the only place in the country with a 13th check. The problem with it is that there's really no such thing as excess earnings in a plan. You need those excess earnings to cover the down years. And in San Jose, we were taking off the top excess earnings for the 13th check, which is
what we do.
Yeah, which is similar to what Lincoln's doing. Central right. Arizona was doing. I'm not sure what they were doing in Detroit.
I'm just kind of curious on the history side of the 13th check. Was this something that had been around? Ours started in the early 90s or early to mid 90s. Do you think these were just kind of plans that were popping up around the country?
I would say in San Jose, the mid to late 90s, our civilian employees got a 13th check, and it was the police and fire started getting a 13th check in the early 2000s. So I was there for that mistake, and I voted for that mistake of the 13th check because I didn't understand excess earnings, and it seemed like an okay way to do it. So I've made my share of mistakes in this business. But what happened in the...
Well, we all have, so that's okay.
What happened in the late
90s... I'm younger than you, and I've made a fair number.
What happened in the late 90s was irrational exuberance. And we in San Jose thought that we were rich, and the stock market was going to keep going up forever. And so we had benefit increases, wage increases, and California in 1999... State legislature passed a pension increase for current employees. It basically gave everybody a 50% increase in benefits retroactively for state workers, and eventually that trickled down to local workers. And San Jose, even though we have independent plans, we had arbitration. So the firefighters got it by arbitration, and we settled with the police So there was a lot of wishful thinking, irrational exuberance, whatever, in the 90s. And these 13th checks looked okay because there were such good returns in the 90s on investments. Mm-hmm. Well, it didn't last forever, and that's the problem. And so now when we're skimming something off of the top, be it large or small, it has a big impact on our ability to fund the losses that we suffered in the bad years. And you know, that's a problem for Lincoln as well as others. But Lincoln's not alone with that problem, but Detroit And it was one of the things they got rid of in their bankruptcy.
Did I read that you didn't agree with the settlement with the unions? You wanted it to go to the Supreme Court for a final decision, or?
No, I've supported the settlement. Mayor Liccardo and I wrote an op-ed piece, and I endorsed the settlement. Yes, I would like to have gotten the case in front of the California Supreme Court, because San Jose has a charter provision that says we retain the right to modify pensions, and in most states, that means we retain the right to modify pensions. So the trial court didn't see it that way, so I wanted to give the California Supreme Court a chance.
You wanted to litigate that issue.
Sure, but one of the things I learned as mayor is you never get everything you want, and sometimes you have to be pragmatic. And so, yes, I would have liked to have had the California Supreme Court give us an answer, but I thought the settlement was a reasonable resolution with our unions and saved the city a lot of money, which was important. And if you look at the dollars, it's a significant.
Were the pay cuts just one-year pay cuts, or were they a reduction in the base and then you inflate from a lowered pay cut?
Yeah, these were 10%, we call them ongoing, which means it was a permanent reduction in base, permanent until the next contract. I mean, the base is only good until the contract expires, and then it go up or down, but it was ongoing. Most of our employees, so that was, we had a 5% in 2010, I think, one time, and then in 2011, we had 10% ongoing. So the 5% that was supposedly one time became ongoing, we had another 5% ongoing. So the net was a 10% ongoing cut. And most of the employees have not yet got back to where they were before the 10% cut.
Okay.
I think our police union might be back there this year. I don't follow the math exactly. So those were ongoing, you know, change to the base, which changes the beginning of the negotiations.
Is it $3 billion been whittled down at all, or is it still hanging in there at that level?
Still in excess of $3 billion?
Yeah, it is.
You know, whether it's $3.6 billion or $3.4 billion doesn't, you know, still seems like a lot. So the dollar amounts that we see here, oops, too far. That number there, which is $249 million, which is this year's number, 15-16. That number will continue to go up for probably another 10 years. Not as fast as it was going up, we hope, to begin coming down for about another 10 or 12 years. So we are amortizing unfunded liabilities, some of it over 16 years, some of it over 20, some of it over 30. Depends on how we incurred them. We have smoothing and other things in there. But so the unfunded liabilities are beginning to come down, but they're still massive.
And the rating agencies are?
We're AA plus or AA1. We used to be AAA, but one notch below AAA. And the rating agencies every year comment on the fact that we have taken these difficult steps with pensions and health care as a plus, and then a cautionary. Same thing, we still have problems with pension and health care in terms of the overall cost. But the fact that we were willing to go to the voters and get some revenues and do the reforms, you know, convince them that we were a good credit rating for general obligation bonds. Well, those, of course, are the same people who have made a few mistakes in the past, but we're happy to have AA plus.
We talk about a lot of the underfunded plans because that's probably what you mostly see in your travels around the country. But what about the plans that are 100% funded? We've seen a little bit of it with what our actuaries told us. What are their best practices and things that they've done well that others that are underfunded maybe haven't done?
Well, there aren't very many of them. There are many that are much better funded than Lincoln, that's for sure. And if you think about it, at the end of a multi-year improvement in the economy and a multi-year improvement in investment returns, knowing that there will be another recession in your future, you should be 100% or better funded at the end of the up cycle, knowing that you may have some bad years. Unfortunately, a lot of plans are they're not gaining back to where they were in, after the, you know, the recovery from the last recession and had another drop. They're just not back there. So the plans that are solidly, you know, close to 100% funded, first, they put all the money in every year. You can't pay less than 100% of what you need to put in. And usually those are places where they're mandated to do that. I was at a conference at the Federal Reserve in New York, which was a conference on how can we get states to put the money in they're supposed to put in. And it's really hard to make the states put the money in because they're the state. But there are states that make local governments put all the money in that they have to put in. Somehow it's always easier for the state to tell us mayors what to do than it is to do it for themselves. So in New York, for example,
we do that a lot here.
That happens here.
It's fairly common. In New York, you know, the local plans are typically very well funded because the state makes them put in all the money.
When you say that, are you talking about the actuarially calculated?
Right, the actuarially.
Because Lincoln has done, I mean, that's the frustrating part, I think. When I look at this, we've put in what was recommended. But when we hit unfunded, we took the 30-year option. So to a great extent, we've done over time what the actuarials have suggested, and we find ourselves in the circumstances we find ourselves.
San Jose did the same thing. We never took a pension holiday. Mm-hmm. We always put in the ARC.
So one of the
caveats, the assumptions turned out to be wrong.
True.
So well, 10 years ago, in a room just like this, there were probably people saying we're in pretty good shape.
Well, the caveats on your early slides is plans should be fair, sustainable, and predictable. Well, certainly we don't have predictable. I'll be Captain Obvious. But when entities are putting in what is actuarially calculated to recommended to fund, and 10 years later we're finding ourselves with a $100 million obligation that is unfunded, I think we have to question sustainability. What do you mean when you have sustainable on your slide? How do you capture that? How do you quantify sustainable?
Well, it's going to be different in different jurisdictions because some cities have more resources than others that can afford to absorb the higher costs and expenses than other cities. So what may be sustainable for San Francisco is not sustainable for San Jose because different revenue structure. What may be sustainable for Lincoln may not be for other cities. So it's what I think of as sustainable means that the city can afford to pay it without going into service delivery insolvency. So no one sets a standard for service delivery for you, typically. We decided in San Jose that we had to set a standard of service delivery, and it was a level of services we were providing on January of 2011. And so we set that as our standard. And we're probably not back there yet, even though we've had 4 years of restoring services after we did our fiscal reforms. But you need to be able to provide that basic level of services and pay your pension obligations. So they both get squeezed here as you figure out where you are financially. And in some cases, jurisdictions have decided to raise taxes so they can put more money into the plans instead of cutting services. And the new revenues is commonly part of how you solve the problem. You've got to put more money in. And in some places they're doing, I guess, creative things. Jacksonville, for example, has a horribly funded plan, and they negotiated some pension reform, and they agreed that they would begin to fully fund it, and they're going to, without knowing what it was. And the proposal now is to take an existing sales tax, a half-cent sales tax, that expires in, I think, 2029, and extend it and take that half-cent from 2029 forward, and then borrow against that and put the money in the pension plan. So there's lots of different ways to try to put more money in, but you know, those liabilities need to be paid, and there are different ways to do it. Other places have dedicated, you know, a percentage of a revenue source or another to put more money.
Sounds like a good gig if you can get it.
And some places they're getting the employees to pay more. I mean, there are places where employees don't pay anything. So you know, they usually make an argument, well, let's get the employees to start paying a share of it. But what is sustainable for Lincoln is a decision that you'll have to make based on your revenues and your ability to pay. And it goes back to those series of questions that I you have to answer is, once you figure out what you want to do and how much it's going to cost, then you have to decide whether or not you can afford to do it and make adjustments to your expectations based on that sustainability concept. But the worst thing to do is to not put the money in. We know that's not sustainable, and that just makes the problem dramatically worse because you're not earning anything on that money that you didn't put in. Mm-hmm. And that's the people who get way behind the power curve, or they have to worry about the usual recession and the assumptions, and they also aren't earning any money on the they didn't put in, and it just it snowballs quickly.
Have you seen jurisdictions change their investment asset allocation to be more aggressive, to try and get higher equity returns, to try and recoup some of that deficit? Or
well, I don't think there's any doubt that the vast majority of plans have gotten more aggressive over if you look at, you know, 20 years. It used to be you could make your assumed rate of return by investing in treasuries.
Yeah.
You can't do that anymore. And so there's been certainly been a shift in asset allocation, much more into riskier and riskier areas in order to get higher rates of return. And the problem with that is you don't always get the high rate of return, and you didn't put enough money in, and then you're behind. But the trend now is to begin slowly to de-risk the plans. Very slowly, but if you look at the assumed rates of returns for plans around the country, they've been coming down in terms of the number that are at 8.5% or 8%. So the amount of risk is coming down. CalPERS in California, maybe the country's biggest plan, I think, has formally said we're going to de-risk. And so we're changing our assumed rate of return so we can de-risk. But they're doing it over 20 years, so it's a very slow progression of de-risking. But if you look at the difference between your assumed rate of return and what you can do in a risk rate of return, it's very different than it was 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. It's a lot harder now to get that 7.5% when the easy stuff is paying you 2%.
Can you talk a little bit about the committee or just the structure of the investment decisions that are made on San Jose's, or what you see in terms of the way best practices on committees that monitor and invest the funds, how they're set up, the advisors, the advisor fees, or any of that? Any comments on that?
One of the things that we negotiated with all of our unions in San Jose that gets almost no publicity, because you don't usually get media coverage if there's no fight. But we did negotiate with all of our unions for a change in governance of our two plans. So we have two independent plans, the council makes the appointments, and then they're on their own. They make their investment decisions, they decide what the assumed rate of return is, and they give the city the bill based on whatever the bill is to amortize the unfunded liabilities, et cetera. When I first came into office, everybody sitting on the retirement boards, we have two boards, was either an elected official, an employee, or a retiree, either directly or representing them as groups. In the governance changes that we made, one of the things we did was to restructure that membership so that we increased the size of the boards a couple, and we provided that half of the members would be independent people with expertise in a variety of areas, investments or whatever, so that a majority of both of those boards now are people who do not have a conflict with their fiduciary obligations. And one of the problems in governance with defined benefit plans generally, and I don't know about here, is that most of the people making the decisions have an incentive to overpromise and underfund. And that's just not a good governance model. So we wanted to change that dynamic so that we still have employees and retirees represented, and they still sit on the board, but a majority of the board does not have an incentive to overpromise or underfund. And that helps with the discussion of all of the issues that the boards have to do.
They're appointee board members that the council votes to put on there, and they're not paid. They're just like many of your other kind of civic boards. Is that correct?
Well, we've given them the power to determine whether or not they should get a stipend. So I don't think they've decided to pay themselves yet, but they could. So they're nominated.
And then do they directly hire the investment manager?
They do. That was one of the things we changed. The investment manager used to be a city employee working for the city manager. And the boards wanted to be able to hire and fire the people that make the key decisions. And that was part of the governance change.
And that's not ratified by the council?
No, it's not. The council, we have to appoint the members, but they're nominated by retirees have a slot, and the police have a slot, and federated employees have a slot. They decide, and ultimately the council has to make the decision. And then the council has some spots that we pick. And then the seventh vote or the ninth vote is an independent person recommended by the boards. So that we've got, everybody's got a little bit of say-so, but the independents have a majority of the votes on the boards. And they're people with expertise. I mean, the average police officer and firefighter that served on our boards did a great job. They worked hard, but that wasn't their area of expertise.
No.
So they're still on there representing the interests of their members. But we do have people with a wide range of financial expertise that are coming on the boards. So there's governance issues. It's not that they've made bad decisions, because if you look at their rates of return, the rates of return were fine in that regard. But that conflict is a problem. I thought it was especially a problem for elected officials, council members who are on the board who don't want to put money into the plans because it takes money from the things they wanted to spend money on. So they're interested in reducing the contributions into the plan. Employees want to keep the normal costs low because they've got to pay a piece of the normal cost. So everybody was saying, well, let's keep the normal cost down. But that can drive up your unfunded liabilities. So now we'll see. It's been 2 years since we made that governance switch. Seems to be working.
Okay.
But that was negotiated with all of our unions and approved by the voters with support from all the unions.
Can you elaborate a little bit on the hybrid plans? You've talked about both the side-by-side and the stacked hybrid plan, and we're certainly hearing more and more about hybrid plans as part of reform initiatives. Can you talk a little bit more about that?
hybrid plans tend to be a way to address that risk allocation that I talked about as one of those value judgments that you have to make. So if you're in a defined benefit plan where the employer takes all the risk, employee takes no risk, you could go to, I guess you could just go to Social Security and then the federal government takes all the risk. Nobody's doing that. But there are many places that are trying to share the risk with the employees. And the hybrid allows them to split that risk. So the hybrids typically would be a defined contribution plan, in which case the government is matching the employee's contribution, but it's just that match. It's a defined contribution. It's over, it's done for that year. Next year will be something else, but along with a defined benefit plan, in which case the government is still taking the majority of the risk, investment risk, longevity risk, things like that, an employee has much less risk. So it's hybrid plans shift the risk in one fashion or another. And there's a lot of different hybrid plans. The most famous one, I suppose, is the federal government's hybrid plan for federal employees that's been in place for more than a decade now, in which they have Social Security, because they are the federal government, so they're now in Social Security. But they have a defined contribution plan in which there's a match up to about 5%. And they have a defined benefit plan, which is a modest multiplier defined benefit plan, and 1 point something per year kind of a multiplier. And so, you know, the risk gets shifted. Some people don't think it's fair to make the employees take all the risk. I happen to agree with that assessment. But even within a hybrid plan with a defined contribution element, you can mitigate some of the risk and some of the things that make a 401k undesirable for employees. You can have a defined contribution plan that has an opt-in provision or a mandatory provision. You can have a defined contribution plan that has centralized management. In fact, the same people that are managing the money for your defined benefit plan could manage the money for the defined contribution plan and do just as well, or pretty close to as well. And so you can modify the elements to allocate that risk. It doesn't have to be all or nothing. And that's really the role of the hybrid plans. Some of the hybrid plans involve a cash balance plan. A cash balance plan, if you structure it right, is pretty close to a defined benefit plan. Because some of the cash balance plans guarantee the employees a rate of return on their contribution and the government's contribution. Now, it won't be 7.5% typically, or 8%, it'll be more like 4% or 5%. Again, you know, splitting that risk up a little bit. And you know, some of them, well, we're guaranteeing you this, but if it's more than that, then you get some benefit on the upside. But there's a lot of different ways to slice the risk and the cost, and that's really the role of the hybrid plans. And there are many places where, you know, the employees want to keep defined benefit plans, probably everywhere. They'd like to keep defined benefit plans. And so, you know, when these things are negotiated, that there's a defined benefit element that helps with the things that they're trying to do, and a defined contribution element helps with the things that the employer is trying to do.
So just to be clear on the hybrids that you've seen, these are not, we haven't gone in and wiped out the DB plan. You've maybe made some adjustments to the DB plan and added the defined contribution at the same time.
Yes.
It's not like you've created a new plan.
Both are
both
true.
So you've seen instances where the DB was capped, closed?
Yes.
And
or otherwise modified?
Yes.
Well, or as my point is, if you cap it, close it, then you come up, you follow on with it with a defined contribution.
The state of Nebraska went from a defined contribution plan to cash balance plan, they plan for all of their employees.
Defined contribution.
From defined
to
defined contribution to a cash balance.
There's like a PBS series where they talked about Nebraska being one of the few that went the other way.
In St. Louis that I mentioned earlier, for their firefighters, they basically close down one defined benefit plan and open up a whole new one.
Okay.
Still defined benefit plan, just different.
But to be fair about a cash balance plan, you know, the risk is not an open-ended check. I mean, you've set a rate of return that is, you know, substantially more achievable than what we're having to come up with in the traditional defined benefit.
And the cash balance plans can be structured so that at the end of it, whenever you're ready to retire, you will get an annuity for the rest of your life, so you can take out that longevity risk. So, you know, they're structured differently depending on what risk factors you're trying to deal with.
The annuity is funded by excess earnings?
The annuity is funded by your cash balance.
Cash balance.
In some places it's mandatory, some places it's optional.
The difference, the value of that, you know, is you're taking a fixed value and allocating that over your life expectancy, and then somebody else is taking that risk, as opposed to you just live longer, you just keep getting your monthly payments.
Well, you take the investment risk was mitigated with the guaranteed rate of return being a guaranteed interest. But the longevity risk is taken by whoever's issuing the annuity.
Out,
but
yeah.
The employee doesn't have to take the longevity risk. So I have a pension from CalPERS. I'm still worried about outliving my money. My CalPERS will be there, but my other investments may not be there because I have that risk. And if people don't have any other source of retirement funds, then that longevity risk is a very serious problem in terms of how much money you spend this year. But if you can annuitize that, then you can take that out of the equation.
You mentioned in San Jose that you restricted arbitration. Can you elaborate on that, please?
Yes. San Jose had an arbitration provision that was approved by the voters back in the 80s. And it was an arbitration provision. It's pretty common in places that have arbitration. There's probably only about 20 or so in the state of California that have arbitration provisions. But it allowed the arbitrators to come in and look around and decide what they thought was the best between competing proposals. The city would say, we think you deserve a 5% raise. And the police or fire, it was just police and fire, would say, no, we think it should be 6%. We make our arguments, and the arbitrator gets to pick 5 or 6, or 3 or 2, or 1 or none or 0. And then times do that, maybe 20 elements that are in the arbitration. So you'd have wages, some benefits, and things like that. So it was an arbitration framed by whoever made the most reasonable proposal, typically. But there was nothing that constrained how much money the arbitrator could spend. There was nothing that said the arbitrator had to consider the financial condition of the city in making a decision. And so arbitrators came in and they gave away our money and left town. And that can be expensive. And so what we did is we went back to the voters in 2010 and provided specifically that the arbitrators, we didn't kill arbitration. We probably could have, but we didn't, because I didn't think it was the right thing to do. We provided the arbitrators had to first and foremost consider the fiscal condition of the city in making an award. And the award had to be total compensation, not ignoring benefits and just focusing on salary, but looking at total compensation. So if you were getting an increase in one area, you might not get an increase in the other area because you had to look at the totality of the compensation increase and the cost to the city. That was one constraint. The other constraint was that the arbitrators could not approve an increase in total compensation greater than the average of, I think, 5 different revenue sources averaged over the previous 5 years. So if we were in a recession, and those revenues were going down, the arbitrator couldn't give out any money. And if we were in good years, and those revenues are going up, the arbitrators could give out more money. So we place constraints on the ability of the arbitrator to do something. And in practice, we've had a couple of arbitrations since then, and the arbitrators have acknowledged they're constrained by these rules, and the max I can give you is X based on the formula of revenues. So it seems to be working. But if you don't have arbitration provisions, then everything is negotiable. When you have arbitration provisions, you might try to negotiate, but ultimately the arbitrator is going to get to make the decision. So our arbitrations are usually preceded by 18 months of negotiations and then 6 months of arbitration in order to get to a contract that would be approved by the council.
Today's agenda provides for a period of public comment, and we'll be adjourning in about 20 minutes, and I want to leave time for anybody that's here today to come forward and make a comment. But before we open that part of our meeting, I'll just ask the committee members if they have additional comments that they'd like to make or questions for Mayor Reed.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, thank you.
Happy to do it.
Very informative.
I know it's a difficult task.
It is a difficult task, and we appreciate your contributions to our work. Thank you very much. So I will open the meeting now for public comment, and if you're a person that has something to say, please come forward. And don't be shy. Or maybe you'd like to ask Mr. Reed a question.
I hear crickets.
All right, well then, I'd like to talk a little bit about our next meeting, which is on our normal meeting day of the week, which is Thursday, February 25th. We'll be meeting from 4 to 6 p.m. in this room, is that right?
Yes.
And at the meeting on February 25th, we'll have three guests coming to present a point of view that comes forward from the police and the fire unions here in Lincoln. And I'm told that we'll have before us Diane Oakley, who is the Executive Director of the National Institute on Retirement Security, Flick Fornia, the President of Pension Trustee Advisors, and Ron Sadoff, Director of Pension Resources from the International Association of Firefighters. The format will be similar to today's meeting, that will allow them time to present their ideas and points of view. There'll be a period of time for interaction with the committee, and at that meeting we'll also have public comment, just as we have today, although we don't have any takers today.
Mr. Chair, will we get information about the speakers before the meeting then?
Yes, I hope so. Okay. I hope that we'll distribute information ahead of the meeting, as we did for Mr. Reed. Okay. And coming out of these meetings, of course, will be in a sense less structured meetings going forward, so the committee will have time to put our own thoughts and ideas on the table for discussion, culminating at the end of our work, hopefully the end of March, in a report on our findings and our thoughts and recommendations. Hopefully we'll reach consensus around these and represent them as such. If we don't, we'll represent different points of view as best we can. And the idea being that we're going to come forward with a thoughtful review of the status of the pension funds here in Lincoln and set forth some ideas that could be useful to people who are in a position to do something about them or who will make judgments about if things need to be done and what those things might be. I think we're proceeding well, and I know we're anxious to get into the ideas, But I think today's presentation, and I expect in 2 weeks, will be the same. It's been very useful as we hear what's going on elsewhere. We don't need to reinvent the wheel here. And yet every community, as Mr. Reed has said, is a little bit different. There's no one solution or set of solutions that works for everybody. But I'm certain that as we think about what is best for Lincoln, the ideas that we'll come up with are found in the set of solutions that have been utilized elsewhere. So I think it's very useful to hear what's happening in other places. Any other comments from or questions from committee members? Mr. Reed, do you have any final comments?
I'd just like to thank you for inviting me in. I know it's a difficult job. Been there, done that. I know how hard it is. And so I appreciate the fact that you're volunteers for this task, but it's vitally important to your city that you come up with a solution to the problem, because the problem is big. And while there are plenty of places to look to see others that are in worse condition than Lincoln, I know that is cold comfort. And when you look at the huge increase in your unfunded liabilities over the last decade and huge increase in your payments, and contemplate the next 10 years with more increases in payments, you realize that'll have an impact on your ability to deliver services to your residents and taxpayers. And this would be an easy problem to solve if all you cared about was delivering services to residents and taxpayers, or if all you cared about was making sure the employees got paid what they've earned. But it is the combination of providing for residents and taxpayers reasonable services and making sure that people get paid what they've earned that makes it hard. And so I wish you the best of luck. Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, well, thank you very much. And on that happy note, we will adjourn. And I thank the committee members for their attendance and their hard work. And I thank others who attended today for their interest in our work.